I've seen a lot of questions come through from Slido, so I'm just going to switch to the keypad. Does anyone in the room have any questions at this point, by the way? Fantastic. We've got someone's put their hand up.
Thank you. I have a question in response to the issue about digital voting. I mean, I think it's a really good idea to have it as an option, but I worry that then you disenfranchise those people who are not familiar with digital devices and so on. And we've seen an experiment of this in the health system over the last 3 years, with a lot of consultations being virtual. And the nice Pākehā people are getting their consultations, but those who are less fortunate are really struggling. So I just think it needs to be multimodal, and I'd like your response to that.
I completely agree that there will have to be some system for people who are not connected digitally or don't like engaging that way, who don't think... their thought processes work in a different way. Yeah, we would absolutely have to have options. But then there's other people, like people who are sight impaired. You know, to be able to do an anonymous vote and be empowered to do that, I think, is incredibly important as well. You know, we are so diverse as human beings that it will require a diverse response.
Yeah, 100% believe there needs to be a hybrid model. We have our enrolments there. You can do that on paper. But in this particular election, 55% of people have responded digitally. So we still need to have that. And we understand that in our community, especially in South Auckland, 15 to 25% of them don't even have access to the digital products. And so we understand you have to have that hybrid so that you can offer that service, that communication, and that support.
Do you know much about what work is being done in that space you're in at the moment to look at the digital aspect of things?
No, it hasn't even come up
because
of... It starts in Parliament first before it gets... We just action whatever they legislate. So
yeah.
It is not even a legislation.
Latavia, absolutely. Go for it.
No, this is my nerdy side showing. So the only country that actually has an online operational voting system in place is Estonia. And it's embarrassing. But I think we could also really learn from Te Ao Māori and iwi elections. So I know some of them are held online or maybe with hybrid models, and it could be interesting, I guess, if that was community-led, but still a bit to go when it comes to technology. But I'm also a big believer in hybrid, having different ways to vote, because also if we think about, like, ableism and I think about my aunties with... arthritis, like, it's so hard for them to leave the house. So having options that actually don't really require you to, like, move and that are accessible, as well as having that face-to-face, which is so important in communities, is really integral. Yeah.
Beautiful. I love that. I'll keep the microphone with Latavia because the questions come in specifically for you. They've said Latavia mentioned acknowledging inequities, right? How do we make participation in the local elections more equitable?
Yeah, I guess just thinking about the communities of which you serve and whether it's led by them, really, but also whether they're engaged in your organisations. Because at our job, YWCA, little plug, we look at intersectional feminism, which is just a big fancy way of saying the different ways in which power interacts. So we think about feminism that doesn't only look at women, but also thinks about women of colour, women with disabilities, those living in poverty, classism, racism, homophobia, and you think of all those different intersections and how different communities may be impacted, but you can't guess, like, Tewila was saying, just ask people and get people to lead their own solutions, because every time the community is going to have a better answer than academics who are just guessing based off research. So I think just going into your communities and just backing people, and sometimes, like, also you don't have to be the person leading things. Sometimes, like, I look around in this room and most people here are people who are already engaged, probably all of us are going to be voting. But it's about how do we use our understanding of politics, and how do we use our reach in our communities and in our families to encourage those who may not be engaged and who may not trust and who may feel embarrassed. How do we use, I guess, our privilege and our voice to make more space for them and make them feel a little bit more comfortable and have conversations without expensive words? I think that's a big thing I've learned, is when I'm having conversations with my family about politics, no one asked for my expensive words, you know? It's just keeping it simple and voting based on our values, because no one cares if you've got a degree if you're a dick.
Keep it real, all right? Keep it real. Do we think we ask enough questions, Twila? Do you think we ask people enough questions about, do we rely on what we perceived knowledge or understanding?
No, yeah, we have a top-down approach. It's definitely perceived knowledge and understanding. I think in recent years, there's like a strong movement, not strong, there's more Pacifica Māori academics that are trying to mobilise their research spaces towards what we want, like the information that we need for our communities. But yes, no, we don't ask enough questions, and we don't seem to think we have the resources to start at the grassroots, because it is a hard job, and it means going out there and actually doing the work on the ground. And we know we can do it because we did it in a crisis. We did it in COVID. So it's just a matter of sort of shifting that frame of mind and doing it for something like local body elections, which is huge.
Yeah. Julie, I wondered if I could ask you about your take on the addressing inequities question that was posed to Latavia, because you've had such a huge experience with the Human Rights Commission. How do we do that? How do we get that right?
I think we've already heard lots of really good answers, but I think in terms of inequities for representation, I go back to what I said before about that need to fund and mobilise people yourself in order to get people to know who you are and get into the communities. And I think it was a great sadness for the Rainbow Panel in this last round that we've been in, that we really wanted to find ways to empower people to know that they could be a candidate, you know, that they could be LGBTQIA+ and be a candidate, and that they would get tremendous backing from all the different eclectic communities that are under those rainbows. But we never kind of got to the point of being able to think of a way through for that. And I think for those communities, I don't see them very represented. I think we need to have a kind of AFI kind of system whereby people who can see gaps in who is represented sort of coalesce and find the people and then wrap around every kind of support. You know, it's a lot of emotional support too, you know. Again, if I use that example of LGBTQIA+ communities, they can take a lot of shit, you know. A lot of stuff gets thrown to them. And when you put yourself up to be a public figure, you know, you also invite a lot of that sort of behaviour, and we already know that council, people who work for council and elected members, you know, we know that elected members have not put themselves forward for election again because of the hate that has come that way, and that just makes me feel so enraged, because, you know, they work way harder than they're remunerated for, most of them.
Could you put your finger on why you didn't get that cut through? Why people didn't feel like they could be a part of that process from that community?
I think we wanted to go through a process, and I think partly it was COVID, and partly I think we didn't, as a group of people, fully get our heads around how we could do that. And also there are kind of some rules and regulations too. So, you know, we had to be very careful about our role as advisors to the council. You know, it could have been murky waters helping people to get to put themselves forward.
We have an audience question here, if we could get a microphone.
Kia ora koutou. I was just going to ask how useful you would think it would be to have sponsored ads on like TikTok and Facebook where celebrities make it look cool to vote and people from even as interesting as celebrity Treasure Island are putting their vote in, showing how to tick the box. Is that a useful resource and would it affect the vote turnout?
I'm holding a microphone right now and I'm going to say yes, 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 absolutely. We have a bit of a celebrity culture here in Aotearoa, and I definitely think, but I think anything that makes quite a serious thing also seem fun, and like what the cool cats are doing, I think yes. And we saw that with Chloe Swarbrick how many elections ago? Was it two? My understanding is that her campaign was pretty much done completely using social media, and she had a very successful, I mean, she didn't win, but she came close, much closer than a lot of people would have ever predicted, and using those social media platforms.
Twila, do you have thoughts on that? It kind of goes back to what you were saying, right? It's the tools in the toolbox. It's whatever helps.
Yes, I agree with what Julie said. Summed up well.
Perfect. Erin, an interesting question here, and we might as well address the elephant in the room. Lovely to see so many people here this evening, but there are quite a few empty chairs, and someone online has noticed that and has said, does that speak to, you know, is that a reflection of where we're at? The fact that there are empty chairs here tonight, and we didn't get as many people as we were hoping for to engage and have a conversation with you guys and to listen to the conversation you were having. Does that speak to where we're at?
Yeah, I think the world has changed post-COVID, so it's interesting that person is engaging online and with this question, because if I had the option, I'd actually do this online too, instead of coming up. But, you know, the world has changed, and we are communicating differently. And I don't see this as a reflection of the interest, but it's just, I think online's way more convenient. But, you know, it's good to be here and have the free food and do all of those types of things. I'm sure people did appreciate here. But also trying to get here and all of those types of things now that we're back into work and all of those types of things, I can appreciate. Auckland has been such the busy, productive people they are. Probably had other things. And guess what? Most people will probably catch up and watch this after the live. That's what I like about the digital platform.
Yes.
Is because I'll go home and watch it as well.
Yeah.
And so will my family. I'll probably share that. So this is the great thing about having something in person, which is my, you know, gold standard, is always having something, seeing your guys' smiles and having your support here today is really good. But I also think the message goes out even further digitally. So,
yeah, well, thank you for being here in person, by the way. But we do appreciate our online audience as well. Twila, someone brought up something that you kind of touched on earlier about how do you engage renters, because you mentioned it. As a renter, you'd feel often like it doesn't really apply to you, right?
Yeah, I suppose maybe I didn't make it clear. I had to think, you got to make the connection, right?
Yes.
So you got to make the connection that even though I am paying my money to a landlord, that money, of course, is being is affected by rates because they're going to pass on the rates. Was that kind of what they asked?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it was just making the connection to actually where your money's going.
Yeah. And making sure that they feel like that their voice is just as important as homeowners and rate
payers. Yeah, it's knowing that my rates are actually, okay, so I actually use the library, so it is going to be affected by that by that money, yeah.
But can we do more to engage those people and make them feel like they're a part of this?
Renters?
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think generally speaking, local democracy elections, we know we should just be doing more to engage everyone because it just, as you mentioned right at the beginning, the trend is going down.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Erin, interesting question here. Do you think voter turnout actually translates to engagement? You know, for example, for a lot of people, they get their papers, they vote, but do you think they're actually engaged in the process, even if they are turning in their voting papers?
I think if you can get that far, you're definitely engaged. During this particular election on the 12th of August, when we closed off the roll, we actually had 91% of people enrolled. And so now all we have to do is get them across the line to vote. And so there is their engagement to that point. It's how do we now encourage them to come in and cross that line. And so there's a lot of things to think about, and what we were talking about tonight, hopefully that has encouraged people to actually get out and use their voice.
Julie, someone's asked, how influential is dirty politics in local politics? Do you believe it deters eligible voters away? Do you have a thought process on that?
Wow. I definitely think it would be at the back of some people's minds. How prevalent that would be, I couldn't comment. I feel like that's above my pay grade.
It's okay. Christian? That's all right. Yeah. Latavia, someone said, and you mentioned this earlier, do you think engagement starts with educating the young about the role of local government through civics education? Do you think we need to do more in that space?
I think, once again, it's just one tool that we can use, because children don't live alone, they live in families. And I think it's not only encouraging that civics talk, but also making sure that it's relevant. Like, if you're talking to kids, like, I never knew as a kid that when people are voting, it impacts my park, you know? It impacts, you know, my playground. Like, it impacts, like, you know, I think of, like, you know, growing up with my cousins and going to Starling Park in Ranui. Like, your vote impacts whether the slide's nice or whether there's a pothole in the road on my way walking there. You know, and so when we're talking to kids, making sure it's like super relevant, so that they can have those conversations with their families, but also ensuring that people are talking about their values as well, because a lot of people, it's so hard to understand the machinery of like government, especially like local. So just keeping it really relevant and encouraging that narrative around your everyday and how local politics impacts our everyday like lives.
Erin, do you think we can be doing more in that space? You know, getting civics education in schools.
Yeah, absolutely. I used to be on the board of trustees for a primary school, and you had civics alongside Māori. You had, you know, these extra curriculum on top of numeracy and literacy, and so you had to make a choice. And so, ours being a decile one school, we had to prioritise those things, and so civics got pushed aside. You know, we'd love to have civics in the education system, but they just have to choose the priority at the time. And so I do recognise that there's a lot of pressure on schools. There's a lot of pressure in that space. But hey, if there's anyone listening and they can put civics in there, I can definitely encourage that. But if this old 9 and 10 schools, they have civics education. Yeah. So that's where you can see that, equality as such in different areas, and you can see that by participation, is because education does make a difference, right? But it's just because, you know, numeracy and literacy is at the top in some schools compared to, say, others. It's just the system that needs to probably prioritise that.
Latavia, I know you had something
else. Sorry, I just wanted to add something. And so often when we're talking about things like civics education and financial literacy, we say, oh, we just need to put it in schools. But that puts the onus on the curriculum. So it's so important that it's a full community, full society approach to educating each other as well. Like, so I was presenting a financial literacy course in a decile one high school in South Auckland. And I asked the students, so 71 students, I said, close your eyes, who's got an FPOS card? And only 3 of them could raise their hands. And then I said, I was like, who's heard of, and then I named a list of loan sharks, and every person put their hand up. And I said, whose families struggled to put food in the pantry? And then nearly every child put their hand up. And this is like real life, you know, these are the inequities that are taking place. So the differences between high socioeconomic areas in our communities who are just trying to keep the lights on, trying to keep food in the pantries, like the onus should not just be on them as kids, they're just trying to survive.
Twila, the frustrating thing though about that is that for those people, for those communities, they're the ones who would really see such a difference by voting for the people that are going to make a difference to them.
Yes, and I think, I suppose when I think of it, like when we've had this discussion, my thoughts, and it's come up a couple of times, like we will definitely be going towards, it's not a matter of if we're going to have digital voting or digital accessible voting, it's when we'll get it. And it's not a matter of if we're going to have civics as part of the education system, it's a matter of when we'll get it. And so I suppose what we want to do is make sure that we don't make the same mistakes which have led to all these inequities in representation when that happens, and that kind of that brainstorming needs to start now at the council or at local government, I mean at central government, so which is kind of a side issue. But I do think we should think about those things now so we don't have to sit in this panel again in another 3 years' time and talk about the same thing.
Yeah. But isn't it beautiful that we're having this conversation? We can start to, we can be honest about it, right? Because we have to be honest. Julie, someone said voting is a huge part in democracy, and I see it not only as a right but also a responsibility, which is such a beautiful sentiment.
Yeah, yeah.
But they've said, and in the last few years, there's obviously been a trend of shifting of power from local to central government. So how do you address that trend while saying every vote counts?
Yeah, that's a complex question. And I think it's empowering, you know, getting the right people empowered to bring back some of that that power back to local communities and decentralising some of that. Mm. Because, you know, a number of our other services, you know, like health and water, are very much being centralised. So we have to really make sure that we can keep hold of the other things locally and influence and get the right people who are going to look at what communities need and ensure that they happen. So, yeah.
Brilliant. Erin, do you have thoughts on that, about the growing trend of shifting away from local body politics to central politics? I guess you're involved in both, so you might not want to answer that question.
I am involved in both, and I think that's really, again, the representation that we're putting into these spaces determines where their power lies. And so, you know, it's about talking to those people that are in power and giving them the opinions of the people is one thing. But because we all have an individual vote, before we actually put the people in power, the power is in our hand at that particular point in time. So there's a transfer of power after the vote. So it's really about having to think about who we're putting into that space before we actually cast that vote so that we can have the outcomes that we need.
We're going to wrap things up shortly, but I just wondered if anyone else in the audience had any more questions before we start to wrap things up this evening. There was one final question online for Latavia. Are you thinking of running for office in the next round of elections?
I'm just trying to pay my shin loan. Nah, I'm very lucky to work in a space where I can critique the system, and it's hard to critique when you're within. But wow, you're really gassing me up online, huh? Thanks.
We'll help you put up your hoarding.
Julie said she's going to transfer it to my account. Nah, Tai lover.
All right, well, let's wrap things up then. And I just wondered if I could get your final thoughts. Final thoughts on why this matters, why people need to vote, why they need to be engaged. Erin, can we start with you?
Yeah, so action needs to be taken now, right? So I'm going to the All Black game on Saturday. There's 91% of people already enrolled. So we only have a very short window of time to get them across the line to vote. So this is our encouragement, is to get out there and talk to people, communicate, refer them to the information that they need, have those conversations within your communities so that you can actually make a difference. Because yes, we can put some plans out there in the future, but now is the time, now is the hour. And so this is our opportunity right now. So if anybody's listening, you know, let's get out there. It's time to activate our vote.
Julie?
I reckon each person who's listening to this make a personal commitment to, you know, you pick a number that's realistic for you, but say, I'm going to try and make sure I take X number of people along with me on this voting journey and get their papers into the countdown. Really small. Think really small, but actually do it. The smallest deed is better than the grandest intention.
One of my aunties, who works night shift, always tells me, if you're not going to vote, don't complain, which is so crack up. But so that's one message. But then on the other side, I think it's important. We're all part of communities. We're all part of families. So having those beautiful conversations, maybe sometimes those hard conversations with your friends around voting. And also, it doesn't matter who you're voting for, as long as you're voting based off your values and you're staying true to who you are, who your community is, and maybe those most marginalized in your community. That's how I place my vote. And I just encourage everyone to vote based off your values if you can. And voting, like we were talking about, for the sacrifices that have been made in the past and for a future Tamaki Makaurau that reflects the beautiful diversity in which we live in. Kia ora.
I'll just total what my three fellow panellists have said. And maybe to add to that, just sometimes thinking of it as a really selfish act, like, you know, when you get stuck in traffic and you get annoyed at something, or when you want to go down and maybe there's a pothole in the road, or like your local pool has got something wrong and it's closed, just think, oh, I can do something about that. Well, no, you can't do something about that, but those are the things that I can vote for or vote towards in my local election. So, yeah, just trying to bring all those sentiments together.
Beautiful. Haven't they been incredible this evening? Yeah, a massive round of applause for all four of our panellists, Erin, Julie, Latavia, and Twila. Thank you so much for being with us this evening. We so appreciate it, and we so appreciate you being here this evening as well, and online as well. Thank you for engaging, because that's what this is all about, right? It's about engagement and making sure that we are striving for a better Tamaki Makaurau, a better Auckland. This is an amazing city. We've all talked about why we love this place so much, but we can always be doing better, whether that's just making the city a better place to live or doing better in terms of making sure that we are engaged in the process. And so I hope you've learned something tonight. I hope you've taken something away. I hope either you have voted or you're going to vote. Go and do the research, read up about the candidates, go and talk to the team down the back. Erin's team are amazing. Thank you for being here this evening. Thank you so much for engaging.